for those of you who didn't know. We're going to tell you something about one of our most recent developments, which is the 8-wheel platform, which is our attempt to improve the driving across the field. Afterwards, Koen is going to tell you how our simulator works, and also something about the first efforts we did on the simulator lane, which already works, at least for our implementation. So, okay, so our current platforms, we have two. This is the 3-wheel version, which has 3 wheels in a 120-degree angle, and also have a 4-wheel platform, which has wheels in a 90-degree platform, which is probably the same design most of you have. Has a couple of advantages and disadvantages. The advantages is that it's statically determined, so you don't need any suspension, so it's actually pretty simple. It's harmonic, it's easy to decouple in multiple directions, but the disadvantages are that you never have full power in either X or Y direction while driving, and the forward acceleration is limited, so if you have a ball here, you want to go in that direction, then you actually tilt backwards a little bit, so the pressure is on the wheel in the back, but the wheel in the back doesn't contribute to your acceleration. So actually, you are more eager to slip, which is obviously not a big advantage. Then there's the 4-wheel platform, which solves this problem. So it's still harmonic, it's still easy to decouple, but now the forward acceleration is fixed because when you accelerate, the pressure comes on the back wheels that are still contributing to your acceleration. But the problem here is, or problem challenge here is that it's statically overdetermined, which means that you need suspension. It's not that suspension is bad, but the thing is that you need to tune this really well in order to drive around nicely on the field. So in our experience, one of the problems we had with this suspension is that the springs were too soft, so when you accelerate, you tilt back, and your omnivision also tilts back, which means that you're more that way on the field. And then you think, oh wow, I'm more back, so let's drive back. But the omnivision moves forward, so you keep on moving across the field. You can solve this, but it's not ideal. But still, the second problem is that you still don't have full power in either Y or X direction when driving. So the objective in designing a new platform is to build an innovative platform that is able to steer the motor torques in the driving direction. So you always have full power in the direction that you are driving in. And we try to do that by building an 8-wheel platform. And it consists of 4-wheel combinations, 2 wheels per combination, obviously. This is direct drive. So we have the motors inside the wheels. We have full power in every direction since we can rotate the wheels into the direction that we are driving in. It's not completely holonomic. It can be near holonomic when you are able to rotate the wheels quick enough. Disadvantage is that it's very challenging to decouple and control this device. This is what it looks like. So these are the wheel combinations. This is a pivoting point there. Actually, that's not actuated. So you rotate these wheels by sending different velocity commands to both wheels of the combination. So you can see this here in the dynamics. Both wheels are moving at the same velocity, you get a resulting force moving forward. If the velocity of the wheels is different, you will create a momentum which makes sure that the wheel combination will rotate. So this is a draft sketch, first design. We do have 4 wheels, which means that you need some kind of suspension or another trick to be able to solve the overdetermined problem. So this is a first sketch, but we have a prototype now. We brought it with us, actually. The front wheels are rigidly connected to the base, so they're not suspended. The back wheels are connected to a hinge, so they can move, but they are connected to each other and connected to a hinge in the middle. And we have slip rings for power and communication, since the wheels are direct drive, so you have to communicate with the motors inside. So I think we can, can you help me lift this up a bit? So you can see. So this is it.
Can you put it on?
Can we?
Yeah.
Sure. Okay.
If you're strong enough, I can. I'm not sure if it's 40 kilograms or
something.
Okay, so these are the wheelbases. You can rotate it, this is passive. You can just rotate this around. So you can rotate it by actively steering the wheels here four times. So if you want to drive straight, you just put them in the same. It's already. You didn't see that, right? So the advantage is you have eight wheels driving in the same direction, which means that you have full power in the direction that you are driving in. So the current status is that we have this prototype. We don't know how to control it yet. So we're still working on a dynamic model of this setup. We're still working on a controller design, obviously. We also still need to test it. We did do some tests with a bit of flight case, but it's not exactly the same because the wheels of the flight case are not hinged right above the axis, but a bit behind the axis. This one is hinged in the middle of the axis of the wheels. So that leaves us with a couple of challenges. The first one, will the field survive? We have no idea what happens when we will put this much torque on one wheel that starts slipping on its place or something like that. The second one is the holonomic thing. So if the combinations are not able to rotate quickly enough, then we won't be very agile on the field, which means that we will be slow when, for example, defending an opponent. If the opponent is driving in the other direction, we have to turn and drive behind, so we will delay them. And the third one is that we always need active control. So flight case follows you since it's not hinged above the axis of the wheels, but this one will just block you. So when you want to pull it out of the field, it actually needs to know that you are trying to do that, so it will rotate the wheels in the correct direction. So it's impossible to maneuver this fast. So this prototype just finished. So actually we don't have much more now, but we wanted to show you what we were working on. So Koen will now, when we have something working, we will obviously show you guys. But Koen will now continue with the simulator link.
How much does it actually wait for a moment?
Actually, not too much.
Not too much?
No,
it's quite a
simulator. Yeah. No. Yeah, trained
strong
for,
guy.
He has trained for weeks. It's now 16 kilos, I think.
16.
So do you actually have a kinematic? Because I think in the moment you rotate the wheels to get them to the right direction, you rotate the robot in some uncontrolled way. Because rotating the wheels will always somehow rotate the robot.
Not necessarily. If the one wheel is moving forward and the other one is moving backward, it will just rotate on its place.
Yeah, but
so
that
will
get some force on the robot too. So by rotating,
obviously, but there's three
the
other combinations that are, you know, gripping on the field. So
yeah,
but it might, we don't know.
It might be complex function, because just rotating this wheel will rotate the robot this way. And then it might not be in the right direction.
I don't think so. It's hinged above the axis of the. So here, if this wheel is moving forward, that was moving backward, it will rotate with the same velocity, obviously, with the same force. It will rotate above the hinging point there, which is exactly in the middle of the wheels, of the axis in the wheels. So I don't think it will. If this combination is rotating, I don't think it will influence the movement of the robot. It might a little bit, but.
Well, I don't think so, because you have the friction points to the ground are not in the middle, so you have some rotation.
Why not?
You can move it around now.
Oh yeah, right.
On the ground now. See it.
So here, and this one is moving, standing still.
I put it on the ground.
yelling.
Or here. So we can test right now. Awesome. So everything is standing still when this one is moving.
Yeah, you're moving it passively now. I think if you get some force on the ground, that will.
But
the wheels are rotating, right?
The wheels are rotating a little bit, not too much, but a little bit. So if I create force on the ground here, this is the same, right? I'm now creating force on the ground by rotating the wheels. So I think it will stay on the place. But again, we will see when we have something that actually works. So you can come take a look when the controller is
at the station.
Any more questions?
Yeah, there's been a lot of questions about costs.
Costs?
Yeah. How much does
Ari,
it cost?
You paid for this.
I'm just asking for one wheel with the motor inside.
They are now, I thought it's right, one wheel combination, 500 euros.
500?
Yes.
For a wheel combination,
but they will improve because the amplifier should, the next step, the amplifier is going to in the wheel. We are buying in China, they are 100 euros each. Okay. But the amplifier is in the wheel, that's the next step. And also an encoder, 16-digit encoder is inside.
Okay.
And the next step should be the amplifier also. Yes.
So a single wheel is just 100 euros?
Yes. You can buy it by UU motor.
Okay. Okay, we'll tell something about the simulator link. Just for tomorrow, but also just to elaborate on right now. So what is the goal of this project? So at the moment we have a nice simulator which is pretty accurate. So we know that when it works in the simulator, it works in the field. At least that's what some team members believe. But the advantage is that we cannot simulate against real opponents. So we have one complete team that we can simulate, but we can't compete to another team. So that limits the usability of our simulator. So I will start with an explanation of our simulator, how it works, how it communicates, how it's built. And then after that I will extend it to how we can link to simulators to each other. So this is actually an overview of our normal software which is running on a robot and on a base station. So we have a base station here on the left hand side, and here the turtle, which is our robot. Now as you can see, the base station is running a TRC, which is the turtle remote control, which is a replacement of the rack box. We have greenfield here. Greenfield is this representation of what the robot is seeing on the field. So that's what the robot communicates to the site. We have RTDB, COM, and here RTDB. I'll explain a little bit more about it later on. And then what do we have on the robot? On the robot we have actually three main processes. So the first process is motion. The motion is doing the real motion control, so the low level motion control is in there. But also all strategy and tactics are inside motion. And the main connection to the outside world is EtherCAT. So we use EtherCAT for all our I/O, so it communicates with our amplifiers through EtherCAT. It reads the encoder stream CAT. So the connection motion to the hardware of the robot through EtherCAT. Then we have our vision process. The vision process is connected to the OmniVision camera. So the OmniVision camera is gathering images at 60 Hz. And when a new image is ready by the camera triggers the process, and the process starts to process the image to find its position on its location on the field, to find ball candidates, and to find opponents, peer robots on the field. And it also has a connection to the compass, and the compass is used to know which side of the field you are. And the third process is the world model. And the world model is actually gathering information from other robots and combining that with its own view of the world. So it's combining actually these opponents which come from vision with opponents which are communicated by other robots. all processors are communicating to each other via RTDB, so that's in the Kambada real-time database, which is used locally on a robot for shared as shared memory, and it's connected to COM, such that you can communicate also between in between two real-time databases. So if you sync the data from the robot to the base station or to the other side, you can use COM to sync it to RTDB. So this is actually the software that is running on the robot and on the base station. On the robot we use a Linux distribution, which is the environment where all the processors are running in. And on the base station we use the same distribution actually. Well, we started with transforming this software into a simulation software, and that's actually very similar to that. So instead of having a motion, a vision and a world model, we actually have a motion sim and a vision sim, but the rest is pretty much the same. So one turtle is still represented by three processors, still running RTDB. The communication is replaced by SCOM, SimulatorCOM. And what you see on the base station, we actually have two additional processors, which are the simulator and the simulator GUI. Start on the right hand side, you see here that instead of having EtherCAT to the motion, we have simply models. So we keep the same motion, but we replace the I/O by just some models of the actuators and sensors. And for vision we actually do the same, but we don't have any simulation of the image processing. We just capture the data from the simulator and just simply process that and communicate that to motion through RTDB as normally does. The world model is actually the same. So the world model which is running on the robot can actually also run on the normal PC, because its only connection is the RTDB, and the RTDB is also present in the simulation, so it runs there as well. You can see here that the RTDBs are still connected through some COM process, and I will later explain a little bit more about that. First, motion sim. So as I said, motion contains the low-level motion control, and what we have, as you might know, we have everything, all the our executables are generated from Simulink. Simulink we use just as a drawing tool to connect all our blocks. And this is the block which, underneath this block is all the communication with EtherCAT. And what we can do in Simulink, we just replace this block of EtherCAT blocks, or EtherCAT connections, with blocks which represent the models. So what we do, when we want to make a new controller of the robot, we make it frequency response of the robot, and that's actually where we tune our controller on. So what is in this block when it's going to simulator is just the transfer function which emulates or is the relation between the current which go to the robot, to the motor, and encoders which are connected to the motors. So we just replace the I/O of the robot, so the controllers are still present, so the control loop is still around here. And of course we also have some buttons and some switches which are connected to the robot, for example the emergency button or in-out field button, and that's simply inside this block is replaced by a connection to software where you can use separate buttons in a GUI to control the robot. So the advantage here is that everything remains the same, so the strategy for example doesn't know whether it's in simulation or in real mode. So because just only this block is replaced, everything keeps the same. So actions and strategy is all running on the same rate, and it doesn't know what's underneath. Then we have the vision sim. So as I said, we don't have a process which simulates image processing. So we just have simply a very simple process which reads information from the simulator. So the process which is also running on the base station. For example, all obstacle locations and the ball location are read from RTDB or from the simulator. And the vision sim process is replacing the real vision process. And what does the vision process? Well, just writes obstacle components, obstacle locations and ball locations to RTDB. So that's also done in here. So it just makes a selection of all obstacles which are present in RTDB. So all obstacles which are drawn in the field, for example. And it says, okay, my own vision has a range of only 7 or 8 meters, so I will limit my range for the world I can see to 8 meters. So it puts a selection of all obstacles and selection of the ball to RTDB, where the robot can actually see. Then we have the simulator process. Well, the simulator process is just to model the environment. So it contains a few models. So the first model is the ball. So it's the scheme that you can see over here. So what does it have? It just has a double integrated to go from force to position. So the force here is normally only present when a robot kicks the ball or when a robot has collision with another robot. And then all other moments you can reset the two integrators to an initial condition. And so for example when a robot has the ball, the simulator just locks the ball to that robot position and then the robot can drive around with the ball. And furthermore, it's a link to the simulator GUI and it provides the information for the sim that you set. So how does that look like in total? So this is what you can see. So we have the one dev PC, the laptop that we're developing on, which is normally only a base station. What you can see right now is also running the three turtles in this case, so it can run up to six turtles. But here you can see an example of three turtles. So what you can see here, the processors on the base station, which are connected to RTB and simulated COM, and here all the three turtles which are running, actually all the three processors which are all connected to RTB. So again, what you can see, there is no other connection to the dev PC or to the base station than the connection through RTDB. And the difference here is that normally one RTDB instance is running on a robot and one is running on the base station. So what we have here is actually all RTDBs are running on the dev PC and the SCOM can just get the pointer to the right location in the database so that it can write to the right location and it can also read information from the other robots. So instead of communicating everything, you just have one database and all the processors can just access data from other robots or from the base station. So this is how it looks like on our dev PC, actually a pretty old screenshot. But it still looks similar to this. So what we have on the left hand side is the TRC, so the remote control. So you can recognize here the simple Redbox GUI. Here you see some basic information of the robot. Here you see the simulated GUI, so what you can see here, there are four players in the field, and here you see some added opponents, so the circles here represent just static opponents, which you can place here in the simulated GUI. And this is a green field, so this is our diagnostic tool. And a nice thing about this as well, so this green field is just gathering information from RTDB, so it doesn't matter whether you run this in simulation or in real, it just can retrieve the information from RTDB, so the same as the strategy doesn't know whether it's running in simulation or on the field. Greenfield is the same. So when you just start the robot, it will work out of the box because it just can access the RTDB. So what you can see here is that there are three robots in the field. And number two has a ball that he wants to drive to here, which is not allowed anymore. That's and you see here the opponents which are added. It's just your bonus that we can see. So some advantages and disadvantages of the current simulator. So the nice thing is that all the software is the same. So the strategy, the path length, the control, everything is identical to the software which is running in the field. So you don't have to think of, oh, this works in simulation, but it doesn't work in the field, because in principle, it will actually be the same. The second advantage is that communication is identical, so that you don't need to make stuff, or you can make anything right there. And all the diagnostic tools works out of the box, and the Redbox as well. So the TRC also just puts commands in RTDB, and the robot will just react to them. There are also some drawbacks, and that's one of them is that it's computationally pretty demanding, because you're running six times the software, or five times the software of a normal robot. You're running it on a laptop. The advantage is that you don't have any vision, which is computationally expensive as well, but all the strategy is also quite heavy, so you see that it sometimes becomes a little bit slow when you start simulating. And the other advantage for now is that we only have static obstacles. So what you can see here is that these obstacles, yeah, well, you can move them, but they're actually static on the field, so they don't respond to what you do or what the ball does. So it's nice to simulate static situations, but real dynamic situations you can't test. So defensive action or found that attacking action can be simulated pretty good. So that's why we thought of a simulator link. And first we thought that that's something nice that we can use, but later on we started thinking maybe that's also nice something for the league that we can compete with our teams in simulation. So to come to your question, whether we can run it on a laptop, that might be too much work. That's why we thought of having just two laptops which are connected to a simple Ethernet, so then you don't have to have two environments on one laptop, for example. That makes it maybe easier to multi-G. And it helps because of the computational complexity of the problem. So you have actually two laptops, which can run both and can run 1C. And how it actually works is that, well, you have two simulators, and one simulator acts as a host and one as a client. And the simulator environment of the client is simply overruled by the server, by the host. So the host will send information to the client, and the client will just take it over. Here you can see an overview of how it works. So here you now have two dev PCs, which are both running three robots. And again, the key here is R3B. So we have two times R3B, one on this dev PC and one on this dev PC. And the link in between is just, again, a simple COM process. And now this COM process is not running internally on a robot or on a dev PC, but it's connected to a wired link. And it's just sending packages from this R3B to this R3B, and vice versa, just to have some communication in between the two and send the necessary information from A to B and in the other direction. So again here, it's not too much work to go from one dev PC to a single team to actually a dual team, because the only missing link here is the communication link and an extension of the simulator here, which can notice that, well, actually another laptop is hosting the game and that you should override your own state. We started with this, I think, just after the tournament this year, just after Leipzig. So far we have something working, and we have defined the simulator link protocol. This is the minimal information that we need to send between the client and the host to communicate between the client and the host. So the first thing is that the host will communicate to the client the team configuration, so you don't have to select the right team or host on or home goal at the two laptops. The second one is the Redbox command, so the host will just send the Redbox command to the client and the client will just respond to that. Of course the ball position, so the main simulator is on the host, so the host will define where the ball is and also contains the ball model which is active, and will just send the ball position to the other side, to the other simulator. Then there's a mode where it's host or client. And then the other part which is more important is the obstacles or the robots. So on for example, the host simulator, you have the robots, and the client should see those robots as obstacles. That's it. So it doesn't have to know that there are robots or not. Just send the position of obstacles or robots to the client, and then the client knows, okay, I should treat those points as opponents. And vice versa, of course, as well. So the client should say, okay, these are robot locations, so the host should use these as opponents. Then we have something to indicate who's in ball possession. So just when the client robot has a ball, of course the server robot or the host simulator doesn't know that, so it just sees a collision between the ball and the robot. So somehow you have to make sure that the host knows that the client robot has the ball and not just has a collision with the ball. And the last communicated item is the force which is applied on the ball. So when the robot is kicking the ball, maybe you remember the ball model, showed the force which is coming in. So the force which is applied on the ball when the robot kicks the ball should be sent from the client to the host to make sure that the ball is actually having an impact. So the idea of us for the hands-on session for tomorrow would be to realize a two-team simulation. So to implement this protocol, either through EtherCAT or to RTDB or another UDP protocol, and you can just plug it in and just make sure that we can play against one of you. So that would be our idea for tomorrow.
Can you already play against yourself?
Yes, we will show it to
you. One question.
Yes.
How does the client dribble the ball?
So how we how the current simulator does that? So when we don't have a simulator link, when a robot catches the ball, the simulator knows okay the robot is attached to the ball.
You mean an obstacle for you?
No, let's just start with our simulator, not the simulator link. So then what the ball model does, it does just tracks where the robot is going, and then just the ball position is just in front of that robot. If you have a simulator link, and the client robot says, okay, I have the ball, so when he intercepts the ball, he should know that he intercepts the ball, and he should send to the host, okay, this opponent or this robot has the ball, so the simulator should follow that robot
protection. What would you do in disputes, in scrum situations?
That's a difficult one, but that's also something that we have in our current simulator as well. In our current simulator, I think the robot with the lowest number will always win.
Or just the host decides who wins.
Right? Yeah. That's indeed something to you can think of anything what you want to implement there.
I think the problem here is the interaction. Well, it's very easy for any team to just drop obstacles in positions that are received by the internet. That's the easy part. The difficult part is the interaction. The interaction between the balls and robots from one team and the other. Also between obstacles, between robots from different teams and from the same team. Well, the team handles that, but from different teams. Mm-hmm. Because in our case, to be plain honest, if you send me an obstacle that is on top of one of our robots, the simulator crashes. So I cannot apply that rule of just overrule what you send me, mm-hmm. because that will crash my simulator.
Okay.
Just a simple example.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there's more on that.
But are you able to simulate with moving obstacles?
Not really. We do have something like moving obstacles with the right click. So with the left click, we drag and drop, and when we release the button, the obstacle moves instantly. And with the right click, we are currently moving it dynamically. But we can only do it with one obstacle. So we don't have dynamic obstacles, we have one.
But you can just override that obstacle position by obstacle position you get from us.
Yes, but the physics simulator does not allow two volumes to be one or the other. That's fine. So handling the interaction, that's a problem. Exactly, if I crash against an opponent, for instance, what exactly? Who manages that and how?
So what do you do with the physics? So what if you bump into an object in your simulator?
It reacts.
So what
the obstacle
robot crashes or the obstacle moves or
the obstacle rolls?
Rules.
Strange way.
Okay. Aha. So some sort of gazebo.
Very old gazebo.
Very old gazebo.
Okay.
So, of course, in the scrum situation, that's even
our server
can always decide who wins.
No. Our population is much better because we can just try two obstacles. We just.
But at least it doesn't crash.
Good point.
We have a short.
Yeah, in certain scrum situations, we just dribble.
So is this made for just one client? One client?
That works.
Yeah.
Okay. And you run a full team on one dev machine?
Yes.
My question here is, would it be easier to use, because RoboCup already has a 2D simulation link.
Yes.
Would it be easier to integrate one agent of each team on that software, or to try to link two different simulators together? What would be easier? I don't know.
Yeah, it depends on your implementation. So for us, it was really easy to just to link two laptops.
But the problem is in the interaction, once again.
Yeah, that depends on what you want there in the implementation. So if you just make sure that it won't crash when two robots are inside each other, then you already can simulate quite some things, right? So we can simulate how you react on our attacks.
So,
and to be honest, we don't collide so often with your robots.
but you're talking to yourself right now, so that's obviously easy to implement. But we talk in a completely different language in terms of simulating data.
Yeah.
That probably is a lot more effort.
Yeah, but just to compare it to whether simulated, putting it in a 2D simulation loop or putting this together.
And suppose we would make this, when would we actually compete against each other on the on situations like this, or would we email each other our clients, which then cannot run on the laptop because it... Yeah, how would that go?
Internet,
yeah. Just remotely.
It's actually pretty easy to... maybe I should tell this, but... You manage to by the end of this day to install our code on your laptop and to run it. Because it's all on the wiki page or on SVN, it's all open.
Okay.
So to see our behaviors is...
So the idea is that we all provide our own agents or have simulated instance running and we remotely send the match.
That could be something, but something else could be that we are just able to make one of our PCs, one of your base stations, that PC is just running always your simulator, for example.
You could run a quintuple boot with all the software versions. You can just boot the one you want.
So we deliberately choose not to model the dynamics interaction in simulators, more of a kinematics, very elementary dynamics. I mean, the ball is has some dynamics, but that's basically it. And still, for us, the whole gameplay situations with the reactive behavior of opponents is still very useful. And that's the part that we are trying, and the fruit that we are trying to harvest here, the low-hanging fruit. And I agree that if you really want to model dynamic interaction, it becomes much more complex. But this is the first big fruit that we
really want to take. I don't think it's really important to have a very good dynamic modeling of the interaction. The problem is that you solve the interaction problem anyway. Yeah, otherwise, we could, well, if the server always decides who wins the ball in a scrum, it's okay, because you can come out of the scrum without a problem. But it depends on, for instance, on the feedback force exerted on the ball that comes from the client. And the server cannot come out of that. It can simply be there forever, for instance. Okay. So you have to solve those, because I understand your point, I understand the interest of this, of course. We are thinking about strategy, right? So if we want to deal with this strategy. But if we want to see that, we have to not get stuck in some particular situation.
Yeah, true. So I think Wouter can show something. So what you see here is the black robots are the host robots, so the normal simulated ones, and the red ones is the opponent team.
Color wise, I can't see.
So the robots on the left hand side are the client robots.
Okay.
They will stay like that.
For now.
Start running in between, I can't see the color, but okay. Yeah.
But you can see that on this side the robots will react on. So
yeah.
This is a kick for this team, and you can see that.
So is it the same software version?
Yes, it's exactly identical software, yeah.
We're trying not to collide because then things crash, so.
Yeah. Maybe you can open a greenfield as well. That works. So you can see now that there's a kickoff further with a red team, but there's still the commands coming from the host will decide. What you see here, number 2 is loaded number 4, so yeah, we need number 6.
So the server always wins.
I think the one with the lowest number, so I think
lowest
number.
Yeah.
I'm not sure actually.
It's not crazy.
We can design it and always attack with the lowest number.
Very nice, isn't it?
It's been long now.
Do you have workshops?
Yeah. Not in game anymore, too much.
So you can simulate the height of the ball then?
Yes.
You can see it when it shoots a goal, it will increase in size.
Okay.
At what frame rate are you sending from the client to the host?
Many birds? I think 100 hertz.
100.
Come on.
Come on.
Come on.
Oh, now imagine all the beautiful games that we are
playing.
Never saw it coming.
Is there any kind of time synchronization that's in place, or you just think that if you send it with 100 hertz, then should opt to be like most currently available at each side?
The only thing is that where you need some synchronization or where you need some real time is for the ball. It's for the opponents. Yeah, in real life there's also quite some delay when you see opponents and you have to process them, you have to send them to your peers. I think this simulator is still much faster than when it's really playing on the field. But there is no time synchronization, but it's a wired connection, so it's...
But it does alter your observation on the field. And if your plan is to do this via Ethernet, then without time synchronization, I don't think this is... via the Internet.
By
the Internet, then I don't think that... Without time synchronization, it's going to be synchronized. Because then the ball position needs to be synced. Need to be as multiplied at the same time.
Why? I don't think there's a real necessity to have that.
The client should always have a disadvantage.
Yeah. If you send the position and the velocity, maybe you can subsample on the client. But anyway, the client is always in disadvantage. Yeah. Yeah. That's a fact.
So then you switch during a break.
That's fair. I have no idea.
You pass to the other team.
Yeah. I wish we had that credit.
You can buy it.
You mean software? So what's the score up until now? Black team is winning by 5-0, something like that.
Oh, oh. See? I think the red one is an old version of so.
Maybe it's your computer.
So it might be your computer.
Any other questions?
Why is that a good software?
The yellow cross or what?
No, just drive through the opponent.
In Leipzig, the scientific challenge, wasn't Newport also presenting something about the distributed simulator? I can't remember the details, but maybe it has some commonality with this. Does it ring a bell?
There was something with distributed simulation.
Was it Newport?
I don't know. One of the giants didn't.
I think it was Newport. Was it for something?
They're also trying to make to also running into the limit of computing power and somehow some protocol to divide that overlap up so that can have some overlap with this.
I think they built on ROS. I think they use ROS for it.
Doesn't become faster.
Lightning. predicted at the time.
But basically for your information, we had a really bad simulator several years ago, and then we stumbled about the paper from Dubox. We actually published something like the new standard simulator for MSL, and it's based on the Gazebo and ODE physics engine. And yeah, we found it online on GitHub, could download it, and it's, and they also use Rust, so we simply switched it on and sent it the right data to the simulator, which we are currently using. Yeah, the Born model is not the best there, and yeah, and also they basically, although it's a strange thing, although they have this physics engine there, if you look into the details, they don't use it really. So they don't use friction on the wheels to move the robot, they just place the model of the robot there where it should be when it drives like it should, for example. And the same as Judas, placing the ball inside the kicking device that every time spent. Although there's still a physics engine turned on, like you have, if you shoot the ball, it flies simulated from the simulator, from the physics engine. But everything else is basically, yeah, part set in this simulator setup. That's,
yeah, I think it was a few years ago.
Stefan, how feasible would you think would be to have a mesh open up template united by linking the simulator tomorrow, by tomorrow night? Just exchanging and then back to the spectacle of information.
Yeah, maybe we can do this more or less fast, but I also think that the result will be if the simulator in charge will say us, no, the ball isn't here, it's here, which is the place where our robot model is currently, then we force the Gazebo physics engine to simulate what happens if the ball is inside our robot, and then these models will physically explode because it's not allowed to get into each other. So there will be infinitely forces.
Some precautions should be taken to post-process and receive data to make it at least physically feasible for the physics engine.
Yeah, and as a result of this, it would reside in different worlds, because there's one world of the simulator on your side where the ball is here,
and the question
and
is
here,
how often would that happen? I mean, just you could prevent questions from happening by post-processing the received data and then continue your normal game. I mean, the chances that the ball is indeed inside one of your players, how big is that?
Yeah, maybe we can avoid this. But the question I would be interesting is maybe how much would this influence our gameplay? Like we tune our behaviors for our own real robots, try to see how it works in the simulator, and then somebody always updates the simulator, and yeah, maybe it could work somehow, but it's not the real game as really playing against us. How far away from normal playing against us would the result of this approach be? It's a question. Maybe we always lose the ball or are not able to dribble as we would expect it to be, or something like that. It's something that needs to be tried, basically. How good this works. And yeah, we just used the Nubots code and didn't change much of it, because with only this few effort we could invest at that time into the simulator, we already were on the same level with the worst simulator we had before, just a little bit better, and 3D, yay, and yeah, further implementation would be necessary. So
would it become easier if the team that possesses the ball is in need of the ball model?
Maybe.
Because then it reduces this potential conflict in the worlds.
Then I believe the total ball possession.
But yeah, I don't know the solution yet, but I think that of a situation where the one with the ball, assuming that you would know who has the ball,
Yeah, but we might both think they have the ball and get like a deadlock or a lifelock.
And the one with the lowest number wins.
So always try to follow the keepers.
Your suggestions, I completely misunderstood. I thought you were thinking about implementing one simulator with a standardized interface so that every logic or robot control software which implements this interface could use this simulator, this one simulator, so that we can exchange binaries and execute it, and you will connect automatically to the simulator and we can start our own, and basically there's only one simulator. That was what I was understood from the first email.
Yeah,